Hi, I'm Jeanette Keynes. I'm an instructor here at Jewelry Arts Institute in Manhattan, and I'm going to show you how to alloy 22 karat gold. 22 karat gold is what we use for the fine granulation, infusing, and the chain weaving, and all the work that we do here at Jewelry Arts. So I'm going to start with an ounce of 0.9999 fine gold. I've also have 1 penny weight and 9 grains of silver and 11 grains of copper. The kind of work that we do, particularly granulation and fusing, requires a very high purity level. We use 4 nines gold, 0.9999. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to melt my gold by itself and show you how you can look at your own gold once you get it and really see that it's very pure, because there's a couple specific things that you're going to look for. I'm going to use a nice, hard, compressed charcoal block. I am only going to use this charcoal block for alloying. You should not be soldering on it in between, because it's very important that everything stay pristine and unsullied by a stray bit of solder. I'm going to put my gold into my specially prepared charcoal block. It's prepared by carving a groove in the middle for my alloying. It's also bound up with binding wire. Charcoal blocks can crack, and if it cracks in the middle of your alloying, you could be very, very sad. So that leads me to the next point, which is that when I'm alloying and heating my gold, I'm always going to stand up. I'm using my number 2 tip. When we alloy, it's in your best interest to get it as hot as possible, as fast as possible. Got my flame turned up nice and strong. I'm not moving my flame around too much. The more that you move your flame, you're going to dissipate your heat, and it's just really not in your best interest to make this happen any slower than it has to. I'm actually going to turn this up even a little bit more. Watching gold melt is one of the most satisfying things I have ever found to do in my life. Since in this first step I'm not actually alloying, I'm just melting my gold into one ball to show you the signs that tell me my gold is nice and pure, I'm not trying to get it to a lighter color. I'm just going to wait until it forms a ball, and that's good enough. Now that it's formed one solid ball, I'm going to show you the 2 telltale signs that you want to look for to check your gold's purity. I'm going to let it cool a little bit first, because you certainly don't want to try to be manipulating it when it's glowing bright orange. Now I dunked my gold in the water to cool it off. What I'm looking for is an eggshell finish, like a hard-boiled egg that you've rolled a little bit. The little cracks right in here. Also, we're looking for a depression. Sometimes it's wider and shallow, sometimes it's narrow and deep, but it will always be there. And also what I was looking for is no funny colors popped up or anything like that. If any of that happens, usually what that means is just that your gold was not refined to quite the high level that's really required for doing something like granulation. Now that I've double-checked my gold and I'm sure that it's the purity that I need it to be, I'm going to go ahead and alloy. Here at Jewelry Arts, we always alloy our own gold. We have to have a very high level of purity, and we have to control the process so that we know our granulation, our fusing, is going to turn out beautiful. Alloy means heating up a metal to a high enough temperature that it combines with other metals to make a different carat in this case. I'm going to take my pure gold, which is 24 carats, and I'm going to add my silver and my pure copper, fine silver by the way, not sterling silver, and alloy it and turn it into 22 karat gold. We use 22 karat gold a lot here. It's perfect for granulation. The color is beautiful, and it just really works beautifully with all the ancient techniques. What I'm going to do is I'm going to get my gold liquid again. Once it's liquid, I'll throw my silver in. Once that's blended in a little bit, I'm going to go ahead and add my copper. I add my copper last because copper is the only one of these metals that will really oxidize, and you really want to keep your metal as unoxidized as possible. So we add it last. Those little bits that you see floating on top, don't worry about that. That's actually just little bits of charcoal. It's not a contaminant in your gold. Now that my gold is nice and liquid, I'm going to throw in my silver. Now that they're both nice and liquid, I'm going to go ahead and add my copper. You see how if the gold is already nice and hot, it sort of just absorbs the copper right away. Now, it's not enough to look at this metal now and say, well, it looks liquid, it must be alloyed. We have to get it up to a nice high temperature and a good yellowy color to tell us that it's actually combined completely molecularly to form a consistent alloy. So I'm looking at the color. See how it's getting a little lighter and a little lighter. It's not that the gold will turn pure yellow, but it's going to have a lot more of a yellow light shining from it than just the orange. So that's what I'm waiting for. You see the color now, how much yellow light is coming from it besides the base orange? That's how I know it's hot enough. Some people will also use their little chopstick to stir it around, but just remember, it isn't stew. Stirring it is not going to make it alloy evenly. It's the temperature that's going to do that. I think it's alloyed. In fact, I know it's alloyed. So I'm going to turn my torch off, I'm going to let it cool, and then I'm going to throw it in the pickle. As it's cooling, you can either cover it with another charcoal block, or if my metal's been melted a few times, I'll often throw a little borax in there as an extra cleaning agent. This is sort of a brand new ounce, so it's pretty good the way it is, but it never hurts to keep it clean. After you're at least sure that your gold is nice and solid, you can pick it up with your tweezers. Make sure it's not still partially liquid, because God knows what's on your tweezers that you might transfer to your gold. I can take it now and plunge it in the water. Be very sure when you put it in the water that you hear that last hiss. Because if you just take it and plunge it in the water and pull it right back out, it may not be completely cool and you could really burn your fingers. Make sure to really stir it around in the water for a moment or two before you pull it out, because this is a very, very hot piece of gold. If you just dip it in the water and then pull it right back out, very likely it's still hot and you could really burn your fingers, so please don't do that. Now here's my ounce of gold. It's all pickled and clean and pretty. And it looks great, and it always does. My next step would really be to forge it. I'm going to use a big hammer, and I'm going to use my anvil. What that does is it realigns the crystalline structure and makes your metal much less likely to crack or bubble later on when you're fusing, which is something that you definitely don't want. Proper preparation is so important in these techniques. You really can't ignore any of the little steps along the way. So after I forged it, I would anneal it again and pickle it, and I would start going through the rolling mill, but that is for another day.